Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining us today for this webinar. Very interesting subject that we are going to talk today. Ultraviolet lights are now widely used to disinfect objects and surfaces from coronavirus and other harmful pathogens. Therefore, this time NISA and TAI Ahmedabad brings a session on fighting corona with ultraviolet light, where we are going to discuss about how these ultraviolet rays are helping in tackling this issue. As many of you are aware, NISA Illumination Technologies was founded in 2010 with a mission to promote green energy solutions, with a focus on solar and LED technology and optimal design techniques. It has created highly reliable and cost-effective solutions. Very few companies in India are R&D focused like them, which is manufacturing all the electronics by themselves. It has a good presence across India and in many other countries with some very big clients in their portfolio like Adani, Siemens, Jindal, Aditya Birla Group, even the Indian government and some in Africa and Middle East countries. I welcome you all to this particular webinar, which is going to give a lot of insights today that we are able to take away. The main focus is going to be on the changing lifestyle post-COVID, how the UVC technology is helping us, how this UVC-based disinfectant devices are going to be helping us and going to become part of our life, and the applications out of these devices, and what all our customers should care for. I am delighted to welcome the speaker for this evening, Mr. Akshat Khare. He is the founder and director of NISA Technologies. He is an alumni member of IIT Mumbai and IIM Ahmedabad. He has more than 12 years of experience in LED and the solar industry. Akshat is also a member of TAI Ahmedabad chapter, and we are absolutely delighted to welcome you all to this series of webinars which we have done together, and there are many more to come. With these words, over to you, Akshat.
Thanks, Piali. Thanks for the introduction. And I would also like to thank TAI Ahmedabad for partnering us in this series of webinars that we have been doing. First of all, I hope I'm audible. Adit or Piali, if you could please confirm.
Hello. Yes, sir. Audible.
Yeah. Audible. Right. Fine. And the screen is also visible, I hope.
Yeah.
Presentation. Yeah. Okay, thank you everyone for joining in. As I said, we are also thankful to TAI Ahmedabad for partnering us in the series of webinars on energy sector that we have been doing. This is the third in series for us. We have done two previous ones a couple of fortnights back. So welcome everybody, and as you can see, is the post-COVID need UVC products. We all have been talking about the COVID crisis, the corona crisis happening in which is the entire world today. And we had developed a few products that we thought would be good for countering this pandemic. And this webinar will basically be talking about the technology initially, what really brings in UVC into the picture. And we'll also be talking about the products that are available in the market, as well as the ones that we have also developed. So I'll start the presentation straight away. So first of all, what is the need of all this? The need is as simple as this, the ease of spread, right? So we all know now, by now, everybody has got enough educated about COVID-19 through all kinds of WhatsApp and social media messages. We all know how it spreads, right? So the ease of spread is what has really caused the biggest fear in this pandemic, because it can spread either through people with a simple cough or sneeze, or when they exhale, or even when they talk. And it can also spread through surfaces, which is really very challenging, and that any small droplets that lands on any kind of a surface can be touched by anybody. And when he or she touches his eyes or nose or mouth, it can get very well infected. And because of such a simple ease of spread, the whole pandemic has become so much more difficult to manage. Now, I'll present two facts. One is that the virus, the COVID-19 virus, can remain on plastic for about 3 to 4 days. It can remain on stainless steel for about another 3 to 4 days. Cardboard, the couriers, the letters that we get, up 1 to 4 days. Interestingly, much lower duration on copper and aluminium. And just yesterday, we had about 27,000 cases in India. Apart from that, there was also a research by the University of Nebraska Medical Center, which determined that 76.5% of all personal items, like the reading glasses, laptops, iPads, mobiles, medical equipments, were already infected in low doses with the COVID-19 virus. So that is a kind of spread which has already got into it. And hence, the virus entering into our homes is so much more possible now, which is what has really, really necessitated the need of all this, the UVC technology. So with this background, let me now straight away come to the technology part. What does UVC stand for, and what is and how has the history been? First, a few facts. UVC, the UV, ultraviolet, UV stands for ultraviolet. So ultraviolet was discovered as long as 1801. That means more than 200 years back. By 1878, the sterilizing effects of UV were discovered. So the point I'm trying to make is, it's not a new technology by any means. It's a technology which has been existing for a long period of time. And it has been very well tested as well. Just to give you a few other facts, that sunlight in outer space contains about 10% UV radiations. 50% of that is infrared and 40% is visible, what makes us things see. But when it enters the Earth's atmosphere, so this is the configuration outside the Earth's atmosphere. When it enters the Earth's atmosphere, then it changes to 53% of infrared, 44% visible light, and thankfully only 3% UV. The UV is ultimately, it's harmful to humans. So the 10% intensity reduces to 3% intensity because of the ozone layer. And where does the UVC come into the picture? We'll see in the next few slides. This is what the spectrum is. This is the electromagnetic spectrum. So if you see, if we move from radio waves to infrared waves, to visible rays, to ultraviolet, and from there on, it becomes X-ray and gamma rays. So as we move in this direction, the frequency of the waves becomes that much more. So the radio waves would be in the frequency, in the range of about megahertz. And then as we go down further, the visible rays and the ultraviolet are in the range of thousands of gigahertz. And after that, the gamma rays are in the 10 to the power 27, 10 to the power 20s kind of a frequency. What we are just trying to say is that as the frequency increases of any kind of electromagnetic spectrum, its energy increases. And the energy is what is going to actually kill the virus. And hence, ultraviolet, as you can see, is nicely positioned at a particular energy level and a particular frequency level where it can very well damage the molecules and change the DNA structure. We'll see how. Now, in the ultraviolet region, it is divided into three: ultraviolet A, ultraviolet B, and ultraviolet C. UV, which we call as UVA, UVB, and UVC. The wavelength of UVC is in the 100 to 280 nanometer, which is the most interesting case for us. UVA is 400 to 315 nanometer, UVB is 315 to 280 nanometer, and UVC is 280 to 100 nanometer. Now, the whole ultraviolet range is something like 10 nanometer to 400 nanometer. This entire band of 10 nanometer to 400 nanometer is called as the ultraviolet spectrum. The ultraviolet light in general is also responsible for the formation of vitamin D in most animals. So we get our maximum dosage of vitamin D from the sunlight. For humans, we always know there is a suntan and sunburn. These are familiar effects when we are exposed to, you know, our skin is exposed to sunlight. That is because the sunlight contains UVA and UVB, which causes a chemical reaction inside our body and causes melanin, a chemical called melanin, to get released in our body. And that is what gives us a dark complexion to the skin. And that is what is called a suntan and sunburn. So the UV lights are responsible for vitamin D as well as for causing tanning in the human beings. Now, what is the natural source of UV? The best and the biggest natural source of UV is, of course, the sun. Now, as you can see in the spectrum, there is a UVA, UVB, and UVC. Now, UVC is entirely blocked by this ozone layer, which is present around 20 kilometers above the Earth's surface. UVB is also filtered to a good extent, but still about some portion of UVB still reaches the Earth. And UVA more or less reaches the Earth, almost without too much of filtering. So the ozone filters out all the UVC. When we talk about the Earth's surface, of all the ultraviolet rays that we receive, 95% of that is UVA and about 5% of that is UVB. So just remember one thing, that lower the wavelength and higher the frequency, that light will be in general more damaging to the humans and to all living organisms. So that is why we are fortunate that UVA and UVB is what really reaches the Earth's surface, and UVC, which can cause more damage to the skin, gets filtered out. And that is true not just for the humans, but for all kinds of living organisms. Now, UVC can kill pathogens, right? But it can also cause skin cancer. So it is a double-edged sword that way. And so in general, we should not be exposed to UVC, but we can be use it and harness it intelligently to kill the viruses that has caused so much of trouble in the world. So how does the UVC work really? See, UVC, that is the ultraviolet C, belongs to a specific spectrum where, because of its wavelength and its energy, it has got good germicidal effects. So what it does is, UVC is the only band in the entire ultraviolet range which can cause damage to the DNA, which is the life imparting element of all living organisms. So the UVC can actually go and disrupt a DNA like this and cause a lot of inactivation in the spread of that DNA, which in this case, we're talking about the virus. So shortwave UV length damages DNA and sterilizes the surface when it comes in contact. The natural source is sun, but there are artificial sources like the mercury vapor lamp, even LEDs and xenon lamps, etc. And what has been found is that even in the UVC spectrum, the 250 to 280 nanometer range has been found to be the most effective against germs and viruses. There have been various studies by various medical centers, and different viruses respond differently to different nanometer length. But in general, between 250 to 280 nanometer, a lot of viruses, bacteria, and germs have been found to become inactive. They have been deactivated because of the UVC thing. And the extent of deactivation depends on the response of each virus, bacteria, to the particular wavelength. So we are most interested in this 250 to 280 nanometer wavelength. Now, talking about the artificial source of UV, there are certain things, you know, certain technologies that we have compared. The two most popular ones, the LED one and the mercury lamp one. So these are the two most important technologies in UV. And we have made some kind of a comparison of these technologies on various parameters. So what we found is that when we talk about the efficiency, which is one of the most important parameters, Efficiency basically stands for how much of power is getting converted into UV rays. So there, mercury lamp can go up to about 40% efficiency. But surprisingly, LEDs, which are supposed to be much more efficient in general, that is what we assume, give only 6% conversion efficiency in terms of converting power to UV rays. So that is actually bad news for us as NESA because we are primarily an LED company. But let's call a spade a spade. It is true that mercury lamp has actually turned out to be more efficient than LED when we talk about the UVC rays. Of course, in the visible range, LEDs are much more efficient. But in ultraviolet range, mercury lamps have been found to be more efficient. Lifetime is more or less the same for both. The wavelengths, LED has an advantage because in LED, you can select the length, while in mercury lamps, you will get different peaks of different wavelengths. So that way, LED is much more controllable. LEDs would be more environment friendly. And in directionality, again, LEDs are a winner because you can control the angle and let the light fall only in the desired place, while in mercury lamp, that is difficult to do because it is a 360 degree angle. But then again, finally, ultimately, all of us are consumers. And we talk about the cost. LEDs are much more expensive than mercury lamps today. So after this overall analysis on the various technology parameters, you know, the conclusion that broadly comes out today is that the mercury lamp is the winner as far as the UVC disinfection is concerned as the more preferred technology. However, what we also see is that the advancements, the mercury lamp has more or less got saturated. There's not too much of scope of improving the efficiency from here. Sorry, now from here on. But with LEDs, that is very much possible. A lot of advancements in technology in LEDs, which are still pending, which will increase the efficiency and bring down the cost. And in future, they could become more favorable. A few terms to know for everyone when we decide as to which product is better and how should we, how should we go about disinfecting our objects. So there are about six different terms that one should know. I'll not go into the details of these, but I'll just state them right now. One is, of course, the wavelength. As I said, the wavelength has to be 250 to 280 nanometers. The reason I emphasize on wavelength is because I could also see a lot of Chinese equipments available, which are supposedly going to disinfect objects. And when we actually bought a few of them and tried and tested them in our own laboratory, we found them that they are belonging to the UVA range and not really UVC range. So UVA, you will not get much close to zero disinfection, but in UVC is where you can actually get the proper disinfection. UVA can also produce disinfection, but that is at a much slower rate. And that requires some oxidizing agent as a catalyst to give you the disinfection effects. So wavelength is very important. Then there are a few terms like radiant flux, which means how much of power is coming out of the UV rays. This is very important, irradiance, which is expressed in terms of milliwatt per centimeter square. It basically means the intensity of the UV rays that we are talking about. So how much of radiation is falling, how much of UV radiation is falling per unit area. And that is one of the most important parameters to determine whether the disinfection equipment is effective or not. Angle is important. If you are letting the light fall only in a specific area and not here and there. Efficacy is important, which is basically efficiency. And then the most important thing while deciding on any particular equipment is the UV dose, which is measured in terms of millijoules per centimeter square. There have been a lot of studies by a few Italian laboratories, and there are a few very well documented papers available on journals such as Nature, which preliminarily prove that above 4 millijoules per centimeter square, the coronavirus, that is the SARS-CoV-2 virus, has been found to become deactive, inactive in low infection cases. So if you have low infection cases, let's say on a mobile or on your laptop or on kind of a paper, then 4 millijoules per centimeter square has been found to be decent enough UV dose to disinfect the virus. However, if the infection intensity increases, it can even go from 20 millijoules per centimeter square to something as high as 80 millijoules per centimeter square. So it depends on the degree of infection which has caught the object. So this is again very important that the device that one uses should have a UV dosage at least above 4 millijoules per centimeter square. Higher the better, because then in that case, even medium infection cases and certain high infection cases can also be disinfected with the correct amount of UV dosage. So these are the various, at least 6 parameters that one should be very well aware of before choosing any kind of an equipment outside. Now, now we talk about the applications and the products. So what is the current method of disinfection today? Either it is wiping with cloth, or it is spraying a sanitizer, alcohol-based sanitizer, or soaking your groceries in water. But these methods are not very effective. They often leave traces of harmful microbes and chemicals on your surface and hands. So there is definitely a need for a more scientific method that way, which can be used for disinfection, and which is where the UVC comes into the picture. Now, UVC finds applications in 4 areas. One is the air disinfection, which would be in offices, factories, residences, hospitals, clean rooms, kitchens, even airplanes, buses. So that is one application, air disinfection. The other one is disinfecting your personal objects like masks, mobiles, laptops, even groceries, tools, wallets that people carry with them everywhere. The third application is a surface-based disinfection, which would mean disinfecting your tables, chairs, sofas, factory places, laboratories, even airplanes, trains, buses, multiplexes, if at all they become, they start back in India. And the other one, which is the most commonly used application, is disinfecting water, which is very much used in the RO, ultra UV RO systems that we keep on hearing about. So we will be talking about the first, second, and third applications. The fourth one is already a pretty established application in the market now. So post-COVID, are 4 various categories of products that have found very good usage amongst people. One of them is a UVC disinfection box. The other one is a portable air and surface disinfection lamp. And then there are handheld disinfection lamps as well. We'll talk about them. And then there are some disinfection trolleys. So first of all, talking about the UVC disinfection box, this is one of the very popular products now because the application is just right. It is also popularly called as Corona box by a lot of people. Ideally, it should be called as an anti-Corona box, but Corona box has become a pretty widely used term now. So this is how it looks. So it has got, it has got like a tray. There would be UVC devices like a mercury lamp or an LED lamp. And on the tray, you can keep objects, and then you close the door, switch on the timer, and then disinfect your objects. As simple as that. It's very safe to use because ultimately the entire thing is happening only inside one single box, and not any trace of UVC is going to be coming out of the box. So that makes it a pretty safe thing, as well as the irradiance is very high because you are confining the entire light into one small volume. So the irradiance, that is the intensity of UV light, comes out to be pretty high here. And the beauty of such a product is that it disinfects in less than a minute. Even we had done certain experiments in laboratories where we found that if the right dosage is given and the right design is made with the right kind of reflectors everywhere, then you can disinfect to a very good extent in less than a minute. So you don't even have to wait for like 15 minutes, which a lot of people publicize. In less than a minute, you can get more than 99.99% of deactivation of the virus. Then there's another category of this Corona box, also called as a laptop-enabled Corona box. It's mainly to give you an idea that a laptop can go inside, a full 15.6-inch laptop can go inside in an open condition and can get fully disinfected. So laptops are pretty popular when it comes to disinfection, simply because everybody carries them to the office and then keeps them at home to do work from home as well. So the boxes, this is called as a laptop-enabled Corona box because it is large enough to easily intake a laptop, and that too in an open condition, and fully disinfect the outer covering as well as the keyboards of the laptop. So these are the various different kinds of Corona boxes available in the market. They are suitable for all these applications. Fruits and vegetables, wallets and cash, very important. You cannot really disinfect cash. Nobody has been able to find out a way to disinfect a particular note because you cannot put spray on it. You cannot put water on it. So this is the best way of disinfecting cash. Mobiles and laptops, very much. Toys, couriers, masks and gloves, that is also very important. Washing masks is not considered to be the best activity because after that it can become loose as well, which defeats the whole purpose of the mask. So gloves and masks without putting water, if they can be disinfected, this is a very good device for that. Keys is another application. These are the features of the Corona box. A good features of the Corona box, I would say. I'll not again go into the details of these, but just highlight a few points. One thing that you should always look into while going for such kind of a Corona box is that the sensor, there should be a door safety sensor, which means if the door is open, the light should not turn on because then it becomes very hazardous. It should turn on only when the door is closed. So that sensor for door safety is very important. A lot of I could see a good number of products without these kinds of sensors as well, possibly coming from various places, including China. Also, another thing that you should look at is whether the Corona box is with dual radiation or single radiation, which means whether the radiation comes from both top and the bottom, or it only comes from the top. If it comes only from the top, then after disinfecting it once, you'll again have to open it, flip the object, and then again do the radiation. But if it is dual sensor, if it is dual radiation box, then in that case, you can very well have just one single step of disinfection, and then both the sides of the object will get disinfected. Talking about our product, it comes in two capacities, 90 liters and 30 liters. 90 liters is more meant for office applications, while 30 liters is more meant for household applications. So 90 liters will be more suited for offices or factories and these places. 30 liters, something that one can, a family can own. Then this is the other category of the product, a portable air and surface disinfection lamp. So what it does is it looks like something like this. It is to be put up in one room and then it is turned on. And then when it is turned on, it disinfects all the surfaces where the light can reach. It disinfects even the air, if there are this virus, etc., available on the air, that is also getting deactivated because of this. Plus, what it also does is there is one feature of UVC rays, which is this, that UVC rays, apart from, of course, giving the UVC radiation, they also produce ozone when they react with oxygen. And this ozone can actually go and spread into the room in various different corners where the light cannot reach. And that way it acts as a double sword. That means the UVC is also going to disinfect on all the surfaces which are in direct line of sight, as well as the surfaces which are not in line of sight can get disinfected because of the ozone going. Ozone is actually also a very good disinfector that way. And this is how this this product looks like. And it should come with an occupancy sensor, which means that when somebody is present in the room, the light should automatically turn off. That is one of the very important safety features. There are manual kinds of disinfection lamps also available, but I'll never recommend them. It should come with a remote, and that too, not on just a manual remote. It should come with an automatic sensor as well, that if somebody is occupying space within it, he or she should not be exposed to it. So that means if a human is present inside that room, this will not turn on, even if you try to manually turn it on. But if somebody is not present, they have left, that is when it turns on. And again, these are the main features of the product. Again, I'll only highlight the features, which is this, that is a human sensor. It has to have a human sensor. Also, another important point is there is a 15-second delay safety timer, which means that even if you turn it on, it will still give you 15 seconds at least to move out. And before that, it will not really turn on. So these features are very important in this kind of a product. The effective area that it can sterilize is about 30 to 40 square meters. And it will take about 30 minutes to, you know, half an hour. If the right UV dosage is given, then it will take about 30 minutes to disinfect that entire room. Another kind of device which is popular is what is called as a handheld UVC disinfection lamp. Now, this word handheld is a bit of a misnomer because it is not supposed to be handheld and then used. It is basically only to point out that it has an inbuilt battery and a switch, so it doesn't require any connection to turn it on. So this is how it is supposed to be used. That means you can put this small disinfection lamp in, let's say, in a car to disinfect your car, or maybe on a sofa of yours, and just leave it there. And then you should not remain in the vicinity of that product while it is turned on. This also has a delay timer, a safety timer. The typical applications are cars. That is a very good application. It comes with a battery, and it is also giving you a UVC plus ozone sterilization mode. That means the ozone will also spread inside the car to disinfect it. And apart from that, the UVC will, of course, disinfect the surface. Interestingly, this is at a wavelength of 222 nanometer. Now, the reason people have gotten into 222 nanometer as well is because there has been a good amount of research happening worldwide, which is beginning to indicate that 222 nanometer wavelength is very effective in disinfecting these viruses, or rather I would say it is as effective as a 254 nanometer wavelength. But this 222 nanometer wavelength does not impact the human skin greatly, very adversely. The 222 nanometer has not been able to penetrate deep inside the human skin, and its effect is mainly on the top of the skin, which does not cause too much of harm inside the skin. While 254 nanometer, because of its different energy levels, has been able to penetrate deeper inside. There are journals on the journal Nature. We had found some good research articles which showed that 222 nanometer might actually be the next best thing when it comes to disinfecting air, because it will still disinfect air as well as a 254 nanometer wavelength, but it will most likely not harm humans as much as a 254 nanometer can. So, which is why this, if you do not have an occupancy sensor inside the device, it is safer to use 222 nanometers and not 254 nanometer UVC radiation. But still, a lot of research is required for one to have a very conclusive result on this thing. Then the fourth category of product is a UVC disinfection truck. It is like a trolley, which comes in a much higher wattage. And it is basically used for disinfecting large areas like factories, or very large conference rooms up to about 100 to 120 square meter of area. And it also requires about 30 minutes for the disinfection to happen. Now, all these air and surface disinfection lamps are suitable for these applications. You can use them to disinfect restaurants and cafes, hospital rooms, labs, clinics, hotels, hotel rooms. By the way, the restaurants and hotels, of course, you know, that industry is already in pretty bad shape because of the COVID crisis. So these are the kind of applications which can give a lot more confidence to any consumer going inside them. Then stores and malls, classrooms, offices, and personal, and even, you know, even rooms of your own size that we see in our houses. So they can be used for these applications. It should be a room size between 20 square meter to 120 square meter. For those, these kinds of products are decently effective. Now, to give you, if we have to give you a summary of what we discussed as far as the products are concerned, in just one single minute, this is what we would like to say.
Coronavirus can survive for days on everyday objects made up of steel, glass, paper, and plastic. These currently used to disinfect objects are not effective and difficult to apply. Understanding this need, NASA introduces a range of ultraviolet disinfectants that use UVC rays to destroy harmful COVID-19. NASA has developed a UVC disinfectant form can be used to disinfect groceries, parcels, laptops, cell phones, wallets, masks, etc. It kills 99.99% of viruses. The other disinfectant devices launched by NASA are handheld UVC disinfectant lamps and UVC disinfectant trolleys, which are ideal for disinfecting surfaces and surrounding areas respectively. So, what are you waiting for? Get NASA UVC disinfectant devices for both home and office and keep your family and employees safe. NASA, lighting up miracles.
So this kind of summarizes the entire 30 minutes of presentation into one single minute. So that's why we thought it might be good to share it with you. Now, before we end, a few do's and don'ts with UVC, which are very important for anyone to decide what kind of disinfection treatment they should go for. First of all, as simple as that, do use it for effective disinfection, whichever product you use. It is not just effective for a COVID-19 virus, but also all kinds of other microbes, including bacteria, viruses, fungi, and protozoa, everything. So we have flu seasons in India, right? So even when the coronavirus pandemic is over, even then the periodic flu seasons that keep on hampering our growth can also, you know, that is also a good enough reason for using UVC as a disinfection technology to minimize the number of times one falls ill. Whenever you go for any kind of an equipment, look for safety measures and automation. Go for as much automation as possible. Manual should be as little as possible. Safety standards should be very well met. So for example, even when you try to switch it on, when a person is in the vicinity of the product, the light should not turn on. When the door is open of a Corona box, the light should not turn on. Those are the little safety measures which are very important, because you do not want yourself to be exposed to UVC radiation for too long. So these are safety measures that one should definitely look for. Then with the kind of brief slides that I had on technology, I think you should be able to see a few things in the product, whether the right UV dose is present in it or not, whether the wavelength is belonging to the UVC category or not, the irradiance, you know, that is a milliwatt per centimeter square, is sufficient enough or not, and not just the price of the equipment. Because the prices, whenever a new product comes into the market with new technology, there are all kinds of different prices, different certifications available, because there is no real standardization available in the market. So one should be a more knowledgeable customer that way, and go for the products which offer right UV dosage, right wavelength, right irradiance, and such things. Also, if you go for a Corona box, look for the not just the outer size, but the effective usable space, which is most important. When we buy a refrigerator, when we say it is a 180 liter refrigerator or a 300 liter refrigerator, we're talking about the capacity in terms of usable space. So the same holds true for Corona box, that if you want to disinfect too many things together, then the usable space should be sufficient as per your requirements. You should look for whether it is a dual radiation or a single radiation device, so that you don't have to flip the object again to disinfect it. And then go for products in the 250 to 280 nanometer category. While for air disinfection, 222 nanometer looks promising as of now. I won't really put a stamp and seal on it straight away, but it looks more promising given the research that is happening worldwide. So maybe in future, 222 nanometer could become a more promising technology for disinfecting air. In terms of don'ts, first of all, as simple as this, don't expose your skin and eyes directly to UVC for long. So make sure that even if there is a bit of a exposure, it should be very limited. The same way, we do not want ourselves to be exposed to x-rays, right? So x-ray doesn't mean that if you get exposed to it, you are going to develop skin cancer. No, you keep on taking your x-rays. But prolonged exposure can cause skin cancer. The same holds true for 254 nanometer UVC rays as well. That a little bit of exposure, you don't have to panic, but do not expose your skin and eyes directly to UVC for too long. In fact, there's another interesting study on glass, you know, what kind of a glass one should use. So generally we associate glass with as a transparent object, right? That the light can easily pass through the glass. UVC, interestingly, only 10% of it can pass through a normal window glass that we see. So to look at UVC at an angle from glass for a small period of time is not harmful. Okay. And the last one from my side is no matter what Professor Donald Trump tells us, do not gobble a UV light to disinfect your internal body. Something that he had suggested to the scientists a few months back. Don't do something like that. So I think that ends the presentation. Now we can have a question answer from the field, which I would like to take up. And with just one message, I'd like to end this presentation. So let's make sure we do not end up like this. Thank you. These are the contact details. This is my email ID and my Twitter handle, and my office email ID and phone number is also mentioned over here. So thank you so much to everyone for attending it. Now we can take up a few questions.
Thank you so much, sir. It was a very informative session. I request all the participants to write their questions in the chat box, so we can answer them as soon as possible.
I forgot to mention that since we have a good number of participants, it's not possible to unmute everyone. So we'll have to go for questions on chat boxes, and then I can take them up one by one. So please do so.
Regarding the pricing of the products, someone from our sales team will reach out to you. There is a question from Mr. Suket Amin. He asked, there are products that claim 30-minute room for disinfection with 36-watt device. How long will it take to disinfect 30 MT?
So see, very honestly telling you, there is no clear-cut answer for it. Yeah, so there is no clear-cut answer for it. If the room is vacant, you know, then 30 minutes are sufficient to disinfect, let's say, a 30 square meter room with a 36 watt device. But then when we talk about 36 watt device, it also depends on, you know, what is the efficiency of your device. And secondly, what is the wavelength that we are talking about here? So as long as the wavelength is in the range of 254 nanometers, as long as efficiency is in the range of 30 to 40%, in that case, 30 minutes is sufficient to disinfect a room of about 30 square meters. size. But then it also depends on what are the objects kept inside that 30 square meter room. So let's say if we take an example of a storeroom, you know, which has all kinds of various layers of objects kept at different levels in that room, that will not be for there for it 30 minutes. 30 minutes will not be sufficient because, you know, you will not have clear line of sight with a lot of objects. If you talk about a normal living room like ours or a conference room, it is sufficient. But if it is a room which has a lot of things kept inside it, then 30 minutes may not be sufficient. And then you will have to probably shift from one place to the other, maybe in intervals of 15 minutes each. 30 minutes is just a general thumb rule for living rooms, conference rooms, or rooms which do not have too many of obstructions inside. I hope I was clear. Was I audible as well?
Yes, sir. You are completely audible.
Fine. I think there was, Adit, I think there was one question about the prices as well. So I think the commercial discussions, of course, our office team can take up. But just to give you an idea of where are, how are these products priced, the Corona box, you can have it somewhere in the range of, you know, as low as 5,000 to as high as 20,000. The air and surface disinfectants, depending on the wattages, can be in the range of as low as 10,000 to 12,000 to as high as 70,000-80,000. Depends on what kind of an application you're looking for and what is the wattage and the efficiency you're looking for.
Okay, thank you, sir. We are moving to the next question. How do we check the wavelengths as well as efficiency of disinfection as customers?
Yeah, so that is the biggest problem. As customers, it is not easy. It is not easy. So that is why I was saying that, you know, even we were customer to one of the Chinese clients, and we found that since we had the laboratory of our own, we could check the effectiveness of their products. And we found that it was not really UVC, it was mainly UVA radiation that it was giving up, and which we found is not going to really have any much impact on the disinfection. So as customers, all of us, including me, are handicapped because we do not have the instruments to measure these things at our homes, which is why we decided to have this webinar to educate people, to educate customers as to what are the certain parameters that one should look for before deciding upon which product to buy, and while also ensuring the safety of the customers. So you can very well end up buying a UVA device thinking that it has disinfected your item, but actually it may not have. So look for the technical specifications of that as well. And as I was saying, look for these parameters: wavelength, radiant flux, irradiance, angle, efficacy, and UV dosage, if at all it is provided by the vendor. And if these things are provided and you are pretty comfortable with these things, then go for it. So it's easier said than done, but at least it will make you a more educated customer rather than something buying totally blindly.
Okay, so the next question is from Mr. Thakur. He asked, is there enough research to prove that it disinfects corona 99.99%?
So I'll share, in fact, we are at the right slide. Here I've mentioned a source. You see our www.nature.com. Nature is the most well-known journal in science. And if you click at this link, you will find a very good research paper which proves that they have been able to disinfect the coronavirus. See, there have been a lot of research on disinfecting other kinds of bacteria, viruses, etc. Specifically for COVID-19, we found two very good research papers. Both of them are mentioned. This one is from one of the Italian universities. And this one is Nature, of course, the most well-known journal. And both of them have that article claiming that they have been able to deactivate coronavirus with 4 millijoules per centimeter square of dosage in low infection cases. Now, the infection, there are various degrees of infection. One is low, one is medium infection, and one is very high infection, which probably even leads to the death of the person. So 4 millijoules can never treat or can never really disinfect the highest level of disinfection, but it has been found to be effective by very good research to deactivate in the low and medium range. And what are those low and medium range? You can very well find in this paper as well. So 99.99% is very much proven there. In fact, we ourselves have done our own research, and we have got certifications of some of our products as well in the various biotech laboratories, where we have found that with the kind of dosage that we had wanted, we were able to deactivate not the coronavirus. We did not do it on coronavirus because I don't think any laboratory in India is equipped to do these kinds of testings on coronavirus commercially. But it was done on different viruses and bacteria. Very few laboratories and research institutes have been doing it specifically on coronavirus, which we have found in these two research papers.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Mr. Bartel. He asked, will it affect vegetable and fruits, and how much time to keep them?
So if we talk about the corona box, we have got the testings done for 1 minute, 5 minute and 10 minutes. We found that even in 1 minute, the deactivation level has been satisfactory, assuming it to be a low infection case. The groceries would more or less be in the low infection case category. So we have found that less than 1 minute, even 1 minute is sufficient to disinfect them. And of course, it can be used for groceries as well without harming them. Even 30 seconds could be sufficient, but we haven't got the research. We haven't got the test results of that yet. We are still trying to make it better and better. But 1 minute, we have the proofs with us that within 1 minute, it can be very well deactivated.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is from Mr. Ganesh and Vasu. They both are inquiring about the time and the calculation of the power required to disinfect a specific unit volume.
Adit, can you come once again?
Is there any calculation for power and time required to disinfect per unit volume of space?
Right. So, see, the UV dose that we see, let's say you require 4 millijoules per centimeter square. But then, 4 millijoules per centimeter square is the minimum that you would require to deactivate a low infection case. Ideally, you should design it for more than 20 to 30 millijoules per centimeter square. The overall design of the equipment should be in terms of like 30 millijoules per centimeter square. The formula is very simple. That let's say if you're using a 22 watts of LED or mercury lamp, multiply it with its efficacy. So let's say in a mercury lamp, it is 30% efficacy. So 22 watts multiplied by 30% efficacy will give you about 6.6 watts. So that means 6.6 watts of UV rays are falling in that area of yours. Now calculate the entire surface area, and then you will come with radiance. That means this much of average milliwatt per centimeter square is what you can get. Multiply it with the time, and then that will give you what multiplied by seconds will give you joules. So irradiance multiplied by the time will give you the UV dose that you are giving into your device. And hence you can calculate the UV dose based on the wattage that you are using and the equipment that you are using, and whether it is sufficient enough or not to disinfect it. So this is the rough calculation. Of course, it requires a little more detailed analysis, but as a layman, we can do these kinds of calculations to arrive at some understanding of whether the claims are correct or not.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is, if we keep object under UV for too long, so how it will affect the object?
Right. So it is a very valid question, because you of course should not be keeping. See, what does your UV ray what does it do? It changes the molecule structure of the surface that it gets in touch with. So if it gets in touch with our skin, it will change the DNA of our skin, even causing skin cancer. That of course if it is a prolonged exposure. Similarly, if UV rays are exposed to, let's say, polymers, they can actually cause the polymers to degrade faster. That is why we hear about UPVC, right? Which is UV-enabled PVC pipes. That means they can withstand UV rays. So in general, it depends on what kind of a surface you're talking about. In general, it can harm objects as well. But as if the exposure is very long. If the exposure is not very long, then you don't have to worry about it. Even in cases where it is going to cause any problem to, let's say, a mobile or a laptop or anything else, it will require a long usage and long exposure before you start seeing degradation. By then, you would have already changed your laptop and your mobile, and you would have bought a new one. Yeah. So this is the rough answer for your question.
So the next question is, are these mercury lamps or LED lamps?
So both have UV radiations. So we have done the comparison here of LEDs versus mercury lamps. We have found that mercury lamps have a better efficiency as of today at the technological juncture that we all are standing today. Mercury lamps have a higher efficiency than LEDs. So if you're talking specifically about our products, they are in mercury lamp. We are also trying to develop a few LED versions as well, but we are still trying to do the balance between cost and effectiveness. But in future, you will see more and more LED products. In fact, LED products in UVC are very much available today as well in the market, but we have found them to be less effective compared to a mercury lamp product.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is, from Mr. Nikhil. He asked, are there any regulations set up by the government to ensure UV products are used safely?
So we have not come across those kinds of safety standards set up by the government today. There are a lot of voluntary safety standards that people are following. So at least a couple of things that one should go for are that there should be a certification by an NABL approved laboratory certifying that yes, the disinfection is actually happening and the deactivation of the product is actually happening. So that is one. Then there is an ISO, I think 15845, I'm unable to recall the exact number, but ISO 15845 or similar to that is the ISO certification for safety standards. So that is also important for these kinds of products. But as far as if you're talking about the Indian government, there is no BIS standard for these products yet. Slowly it will also come into the picture. But as long as you use common sense and see that it has sufficient safety features and that the vendor from where you're procuring has got decent enough certifications as well with him, it should. But there is no Bureau of Indian Standards guidelines for these products yet.
Thank you, sir. So how many more questions are we taking right now?
I think we should do it for another 10 minutes if Ty doesn't have too much of objection.
Yeah, sure. So the next question is, how much time is required to set the Corona box? How much time is required to set the Corona box for a one-time usage?
To set it up, it's very simple. You know, whatever time you would require to open the door and put your equipments inside. That's all. Nothing more than that. So it will just hardly take seconds. After that, you close the door and switch it on. Once you switch it on, you have to see it for only 1 minute. After 1 minute, you can be rest assured that your equipments have been very well disinfected. This, by the way, this 1 minute, I'm talking specifically about our own box. Different manufacturers can have different specifications. Some may come with 15 minutes, some may come with 10 minutes, depending on the dosage that they are talking about. We thought that time is important for everyone and everybody wants a fast solution. So we try to put the UV dosage in such a way that things can get disinfected within 1 minute. So hardly one step process will take about 1 minute for disinfection, another 30 seconds for putting up your equipments, 1.5 minutes.
Okay, so the next Mr. Singh writes, "Hi Akshat, how do you ensure 360 degree disinfection in the Corona box? What I understood from this presentation is that top and bottom is taken care with light from top and bottom, but the other sides of the objects are not covered."
Right, so again, that's a good point. And for that, there are supposed to be good reflectors on the walls. So, which is what we have done in our box, that there is supposed to be a good reflectivity of the walls, where we put certain aluminium-based reflectors with good reflectivity, so that even if the light falls on the walls, it gets duly reflected back, it's kept on the tray. So that is how the whole entire optical design is such. So which is why I was saying that one should not just be looking for the wattage, the wattage of the box or the size of the box, but a lot of these little issues, features can make a hell lot of a difference. So you are very right in this thing, that what happens to the light that gets wasted outside, and that has to be properly reflected back to the objects which you want to disinfect, and that is achieved through the right optical design through reflectors.
Okay, thank you, sir. So the next question is from Mr. Patel. Is he asked how to find which lamp is used in the box, either it is UV A, B, or C?
So yeah, I think I've already answered it. As a normal consumer, it may not be easily possible to find that out, because we don't have the right equipments with us. If you want our services on that, we'll help you out in that in a few cases, of course, without charging any fee. Where if you want any particular boxes and you want to evaluate them, do send it to our laboratory and we can tell you whether this is giving you the UVA or UVB or UVC. So at least that much we can do for our audience. But as a normal consumer, you and I cannot find that out sitting at home.
Thank you so much, sir. The next question is from Mr. Ganesh. He asked how to apply for certification of such products and what kind of certifications are generally needed for it.
So I would say go for any kind of an NABL approved laboratory, which is into biotechnology. And those would be the right laboratories to approach for getting certifications. That would be the product certification from a laboratory. Apart from that, for the safety features, you can go for the ISO certification that I talked about, which is ISO 15858. I'm sorry, I'm not exactly remembering the exact number, but it is ISO 15858 or 845, something like that. You can go for CE certification. That is also safety standards up to the European standards, safety standards conforming to the European standards. And but if you're talking about a government issued standard, like a BIS standard, that is not yet there for these products, which we hope will very soon come into the picture.
Thank you, sir. So the next question is from Mr. Chirag. He asks, can you use rays in case of portable lamp or trolley produce communication interference?
No, it won't cause any communication interference. The communication interference is caused by a different wavelength. UVC will not have any impact on that.
Okay, so the next question is from Mr. Sunil. He asked, does the NASA products have certifications and which are they?
So yes, we have the safety certification for the ISO standards. We have applied for CE certifications as well. And we also have the test laboratory certifications of these products, which prove that you can have a satisfactory result within 1 minute. The deactivation of the pathogens can happen within 1 minute and within a certain few minutes. So we do have those certifications, yes.
Okay, sir. I guess that's it. We are not getting any more questions right now.
Fine.
Viewers, you can write us at info@nasa.in for further questions, or you can also WhatsApp us. on the number from which you have got the reminders for the webinar. Meanwhile, you can, if you have any questions right now, you can write in the chat box. We are open for a few more minutes.
I think let us just mention our email ID here. So on these email IDs, you can put up your questions, which even if they are non-commercial questions, anything about technology or anything that you want to gain out of knowledge, we'll be happy to help you out on those things. So I think Adit, we should call it off now.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. The video will be uploaded on YouTube later on, and the links will be shared to you, so you can have it afterwards, even if you have joined the late.
You can also find all our past webinars on our website link as well. If you go to our website, there's a webinar link there, and this will also be uploaded by tomorrow or by day after tomorrow maximum, so you can get the video recording of everything. Apart from that, Adit, please take a note of anybody who wants it separately and send it to them.
Sure.
Fine. Thank you so much, everyone, for attending it, and wish you all the very best. Thank you.
Thank you guys for joining us. We'll end the meeting right now.
Okay. Thanks, Adit.
Yep. Thanks.